Sudan, once the giant of Africa, is no more. In January 2011, the South voted overwhelmingly to break away. And today, many Northerners fear that this is only the beginning.
My country is going. I seriously believe that the South is not the end of it.
Some believe that a revolution similar to those across the Arab world is inevitable.
السودان هتحصل فيه ندرة اللي هو النظام القاعد النظام الإسلامي العروبي القاعد ما حيقدر يواصل كتير وحيرفض الشعب السوداني برا.
But with the economy struggling and shortages increasing daily, others are more concerned just with basic survival. And behind the doors of mosques across the country, a battle for souls and ultimately power has begun.
We Sufis need to come to a point to say enough is enough.
Every Friday afternoon in Omdurman, they gather to celebrate the religion in a way only Sufis can. Often described as Islamic mysticism, Sufism is a unique interpretation of Islamic ideas, emphasizing respect for love, tolerance, and peace. The highlight comes as whirling dervishes spin themselves into an hypnotic trance, bringing them ever closer to their God. Standing in the crowd is a man who left Sudan over 20 years ago for Brooklyn, New York. Saeed Tabidi is facing a momentous decision over whether to move himself and his family back to the land of his birth.
I found things are different now than 20 years ago. Everything is different. Some people came on top of everything. And some people, they lost everything. It's a totally different life than it was before.
Saeed's family run one of the last jewelry makers in Sudan. Three generations of Tabidis working side by side, crafting precious metals under the guidance of eldest brother, Bulbul. But after 500 years, the family business is in danger of closing, an ancient skill disappearing, perhaps forever.
Our family, they struggle a lot, and they're living day by day. So that they cannot save anything because they're not much work to do. Because they import a lot of stuff from China, they import a lot of stuff from other countries. And they mess up the handcraft work in Sudan.
Most of the work has come from outside, from the Gulf, from Bahrain, from Singapore, from Kuwait. So all the traditional work that my family used to do, it's stopped. We're almost like not doing anything no more. This market used to be for all workers. They used to be sitting here doing this kind of work. Now they're not doing it anymore. Then they vanished. This is how it's changed. It's all became like a market for a Chinese stuff. We have all plastic and there's no more workers that works here anymore.
But not all vendors see it Saeed's way.
هاي تقليدي
مكان تقليدي
هاي
وحاسه دخلت التطور الجديد ده
تطور
تغير يعني
تغير ليه
لكن نفس الديزاين نفس
الشكل
نفس هنا لكن بطريقه احدث
لكن ما كده هسه في صناعات كده بتكون في البلد بتنتهي
في صناعات الإنتاج اللي هو يعني مثلاً كان
الحدادين والسمكرية والجوان
السمكرية دي ما بقت موضات مع الجيل الجديد الناس اللي أغلى من
التكلفة الصينية.
فأنت لما تبقى السوداني مثلاً وتبقى الصيني وتبقى
السعر بيختلف
مختلف أو أقل سعراً المواطن
دار تمشي دار حاجة رخيصة
قدر يجيبه مثلاً.
China's first interest in Sudan followed the discovery of huge reserves of oil. American companies had pulled out because of the civil war, and so the Sudanese turned east for help.
So we went to the Chinese. God sent us the Chinese. And we went to the Chinese. The Chinese came with their credit and came with the technology, the very technology they acquired from the United States, and they started developing oil in the Sudan. And from that time on, the Chinese started from what I call a small foothold in Sudan to spread out all over Africa. And now the Chinese are everywhere.
The Chinese are notoriously secretive about talking business in public. But the man who changed the face of Sudan over the last two decades agreed to speak with us. Built on the outskirts of the capital, Khartoum, locals call this complex Little China. And this is the man who first alerted the Chinese government to oil opportunities in Sudan.
اسمي في اللغة الصينية جان شيفو. عندي اسم إسلامي وحاج صافي.
A convert to Islam, he believes China's involvement in Sudan has been entirely positive.
عملنا عملا كبيرا في مجال التعاون الاقتصادي والتجاري بين
How do you answer the people who say that the Chinese imports have actually destroyed jobs in Sudan?
No, خصوصاً تنمية اقتصاد وطني.
But one of Sudan's leading economists and its former Minister of State for Finance is concerned that China's commitment to her country may be short-lived.
Yes, the Chinese were there when we had the oil. But will the Chinese be there after the oil? They have been increasingly been interested in the agriculture, but not as much. So it is a big question whether your former friends will be your next friends. And oil was greatly profitable. That was why the Chinese and the Asians were willing to come in. But with agriculture and with other productive sectors, you need to have patience and a longer time frame for your investments.
Lying between Omdurman and Khartoum, at the point where the blue and white Niles converge, Tuti Island has been famous for its agriculture since the Nubian tribes arrived from the north many hundreds of years ago.
هاي طبعا ده قديمه هي عمرها اكثر من 350 سنه توت عريقه يعني بدوا الزراعه من بدري لكن طبعا الزراعه ناس اقتبسوها من الشمال يعني لانه الناس اللي كانوا جو من الشمال بيزرعوا الخضار هنا طبعا الغالب في الغالب والعام هنا بس الخضار والعلف بتاع البهايم اللي هو البرسين ده يعني ما في صناعه ما في كده وان كان في حاجات بسيطه اللي هي المصانع البسيطه الكمائن بتاعت الطوب دي النيل انا كساكن غاطن مع النيل بعني الحياه طبعا للانسان لانه الحياه مستمده من النيل الناس مرتبطين به ارتباط شديد اللي هي الزراعه وان كان في الفتره الاخيره طبعا توتي بقت يعني انحصرت الرقعه الزراعيه فيها.
With temperatures soaring to above 50 degrees centigrade, Hamdi relies on an Indian-built pump from the days of the British Empire to supply his farm. Back then, water was in plentiful supply, but that's all changing. As populations rise in neighboring countries further up the Nile, the demand for the river's water has increased dramatically. All around northern Sudan, the Nile is beginning to dry up.
اللي هو جحفل معناه نهاية الحياة بالنسبة للناس نهاية الحياة طبعا لا يوجد ساكن في الطفاف النيل طبعا بعين النهاية حيستمدوا الحياة من وين؟ حيشربوا من وين؟ حيزرعوا من وين؟ حياكلوا من وين؟ أنا في عمري ما شفت كلام زي ده.
Negotiations are taking place between neighboring countries. And with the population of the Nile Basin expected to double to over 300 million people over the next 25 years, Khartoum's chief negotiator says a solution is urgent.
And I think this will be on the increase. Each year, you will see much of this sand and this island. And this is why it is very important for the all Nile Basin countries to cooperate.
But the last agreement was back in 1959. When Egypt and Sudan claimed most of the water. In the new negotiations, it's unlikely that countries upriver, such as the new South Sudan, will allow a repetition.
Negotiations have started on this issue between the North and the South 6 or 7 months ago. And basically, the idea is that to conclude an agreement between the North and the South to enable each of the two countries North Sudan and South Sudan to use the water resources.
The need to conclude that agreement urgently soon became apparent.
Can I stop you a second? It seems we're stuck. That's indicative of the problem, surely. He's having to lift the engine up just to try and get himself up. Yeah.
وكما هناك في مياه جوفية يمكن حفر أبار ما في أي خطورة يعني بالنسبة لنا تنمية زراعية أعتقد هذا له مستقبل باهر ما في أي خطورة إذا مياه في النيل متوفرة كثير.
For Saeed Tabidi, his priority is to try to expand the family business during his visit to Sudan. Tonight, he's launching an exhibition of their work at Omar El Fadli's restaurant in central Khartoum.
This is our work. It's the Tabidi's family. We do jewelry and woodwork, and we work with copper and silver and gold. And, this piece here, it's about the separation of the Sudans. We make it like it's two pieces, but they still attached together. And, after the separation.
It's a very, it has a sad...
It's a sad thing.
Psychologically, when you get part of your body removed, your body cannot, you know, take that fact. And some people feel that they still have that limb, although it's not there.
But it's not just psychological. It's about economics too. When the country was won, the natural resources, especially the massive oil reserves, kept the economy running. But most of those reserves are in the south.
It is true that oil, or 85% of it, does exist in the south. The remaining really is barely enough for our, you know, use. What's unfortunate is that during the time that we have those resources, we have not invested in other projects to replace them or to replace the income from them. We find ourselves after 15, 20 years, we have nothing because of the separation.
The current pipeline runs northwards from the oil fields towards Port Sudan on the Red Sea. But plans are being laid in the south to build a pipeline running through Kenya to the coast. The implications of this for the northern economy will be severe.
The country's debt is standing at $36 billion, with 80% of that in arrears. So unless you resolve your debt problem, you will not be eligible for new financing. The debt issue was not resolved when the oil was available because the government did not have an immediate need for it.
Many of the loans and investments came from China. The big question is how long the Chinese will continue that relationship with the inevitable decline in oil revenues.
Sudan
Isn't it a big worry that the south has now gone and most of the oil was there?
هنا طبعا شيء سياسي. أنا عادة لا أتدخل في شؤون داخلية سياسية. أنا رجل أعمال أهتم في شغل بس.
Government ministers claim that the north itself has potentially lucrative reserves of oil and gas, and that the discovery of gold deposits in recent years could make up the shortfall in revenue from its loss of southern oil.
وسيوجه إلى الداخل ستكون هناك شكل من أشكال المعاناة لكن لا أتصور أنها يمكن أن تهز الاقتصاد السودان. الشمال فيه يعني فيه بترول كذلك فيه غاز حقيقي حقول حقيقية مكتشفة للغاز. السودان الآن بدأ في تصدير الذهب بمقدار 70 طن سنويا من الذهب.
The government is talking about gold replacing oil revenues. But our gold exports so far are about $1 billion for 2010. Projections are that they will rise definitely, but they cannot definitely not replace the oil revenues, which account for 90% of our exports. So there will be dire adjustment needed by the government. In order to do this adjustment, it will need to resolve its political problems.
This is a reference to what many now call the New South. Disputed regions stretching across much of the border area from Blue Nile State in the east through the Nuba Mountains, South Kordofan, and the continuing conflict in Darfur.
Don't you face the danger of other regions of currently North Sudan breaking away?
Well, that could be entertained in political arguing and wrangling between the different political forces. I don't think the separatist forces in other parts of the country are as strong as they are or they were in the south. So I'm not really worried about that.
In Darfur, where President Bashir is charged by the International Criminal Court of Crimes Against Humanity, both the North and South are accused of supplying weapons to militias, fueling a proxy war which could spiral out of control.
If they start war by proxy, if we can call it so, then they are inviting for not neighborly relationship, but violent or aggressive relationship.
War.
Exactly.
If the South starts to espouse, you know, kind of ideology that encourages other regions in the north to secede, that will, of course, would ignite a war between the north and the south.
The words of Joseph Lagu, former rebel leader and now advisor to Southern President Salva Kiir, will cause concern in northern circles.
It will be wrong for those who claim to be the power base in the north to think that they have got rid of the South, and now they will have free hand. They will not have free hand, because those others will rise as well.
So in many ways, you see the breakaway of the South as just the beginning.
It is the beginning of the total disintegration of what was the Sudan.
The ideological struggle between North and South runs deep. And the greatest danger is that standoffs and shared threats amongst the political elite could lead to conflict on the ground. The most dangerous flashpoint straddles the border and is claimed by both the North and South, Abyei. The Miseria nomads from the dry region to the north of Abyei have for hundreds of years traveled through lands occupied by the southern Dinka Nok tribe to take their cattle to pasture. In recent times, the Dinka Nok have been refusing to allow them to cross the border, but heavily armed Miseria militias are determined to uphold what they say is their right of passage.
نحن المسيرية متواجدين في هذا المنطقة ليس من دعاة الحرب أو الفتن أو دعاة أي عمل عنصري. لكن لنا حق ولنا قضية ونحن موجودين هنا وحاملين هذا السلاح من أجل أنفسنا وثروتنا الحيوانية.
But the Dinka Nok, who wish to join the new South Sudan, are equally determined to stand their ground.
Whether Masira like it or not, we are South. We Dinka Nok, we are South. We are not Northerns, and we are not Masira.
Anyone in Abyei for the North?
No.
All of us, we need to be part of South Sudan.
Those involved in mediating between the two groups believe the tribes are being manipulated by rival governments.
The Masiria been supported by the government in Khartoum, and the Dinka has been supported by the government in Juba, and two of them are proxies for Khartoum and Juba, and that is what created what make the problem more difficult.
In January 2011, while the main referendum on southern independence took place as scheduled, another referendum to decide whether Abyei would become part of the North or South was cancelled when it couldn't be agreed exactly who had the right to vote.
When the American mediator made a proposal that everybody who lives in the area for 185 days, we accepted that proposal, and the SPLM rejected that proposal, and that was the reason why we didn't have a referendum on the 9th of January.
The SPLM, governing party in the South, claims that the North supplies arms to the Miseria, something Khartoum has difficulty answering.
Does your government or military supply arms to the Miseria, and has it ever done?
No. We don't have such policy.
Have you ever, to your knowledge, have you ever supplied arms to the Miseria?
We have supplied arms to all tribal groups who were affiliated with the army as popular defense forces.
Including the Miseria?
Well, of course. I mean, they were not directed against a particular group in the population.
Accused of not doing enough to protect the Dinka Nok population from Miseria attacks in the past, the United Nations increased its presence in Abyei.
So from all our planning, we are in a good position now to address the challenge of Abyei if maybe militias attempt to cause maybe casualties on the people.
But the UN were in no position, nor had the mandate to take on a national army. In May 2011, following an attack by southern troops on one of its convoys, Khartoum sent its full military might to occupy Abyei, causing the local Dinka Nok population to flee across the border to the south. Short-term solutions such as foreign peacekeeping forces simply postponed what many fear will be inevitable conflict.
For the Dinka Nok and the Miseria, this is their land, for which they are willing to die. It is very unfortunate. No one has an answer to it. And yani, many people say this is the Kashmir of Sudan.
For many hundreds of years, Sufism has been the mainstay of religious worship in Sudan.
And Sufism actually is the core of Islam. This is the way the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, was worshipping and remembering Allah Almighty. Mixing the material or the external side of Islam with the core, which is the spirit. Whenever you got something which is very affectionate, which is very touching actually to your heart, you can always move. You can notice it even in the children. When you play music, they just start to move.
Although Sufism has been the religion of the Sudanese establishment, Its leaders have traditionally steered clear of politics and the pursuit of power. But now tensions are rising between Sufism and a fast-growing ultra-conservative Islamic movement with its roots in Saudi Arabia. Salafism aims to return Sudan to the most traditional understanding of Sharia law. Salafists show little hesitation in attacking Sufis, whom they accuse of modernism and betraying the original principles of Islam. Until recently, its leaders have never been in a position to achieve quietly held political ambitions in Sudan. But a newfound confidence, aligned to vastly expanding numbers, has brought them into the open in a way that is beginning to shake Sudanese society.
They never had nothing to do with the politics. And all of a sudden, they just shifted because they think that there is a big territory that they can take. And this is very much interesting because the agreement they did with the Saudi government long time ago, that they have only the Islamic teaching, and they never touched politics.
وبالتالي يتعاملون معه إذا فتح لهم مجالات من في مقام الإصلاح في 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 أن 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 يقوموا ب يعني مناصب أن يتولوا مناصب لمقام الإصلاح فهذا كان لا تجده من 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 قبل السلاطين في في العهد الأول ولكن بعض السياسات في في الحكم وخاصة في السودان.
The main target for Salafists is the youth of Khartoum, particularly those studying at university, whom they see as tomorrow's leaders.
في أوساط الشباب باعتبار أن الشباب هو الفئة المستنيرة التي تقبل العلم بأدلته في زمان صارت المعلومة عند الناس وعند الشباب كطائم لا بد لها من التوثيق.
Although female Salafi students dressed in full niqab would not speak with us, their male counterparts were proud to boast of what has become the fastest growing movement at Khartoum University.
ماشي جديد جدا حتى قلت لك كل سنه عدد الطلاب الملتزمين بيزيدوا والنشاطات ماشيه زايده والنشاطات الدعويه والمحاضرات والدورات ماشيه زايده.
Their posters adorn the walls of the university, and the message is clear. We are coming. Their student leaders have no hesitation in linking religion and politics.
لأن الحركات السلفية في جامعة خرطوم هي خطابة يعني خطابة أقوى. لأن أصلا الفهم الصحيح للإسلام والسلفية يعني بما سمى السلفية يعني مبناها على إنه الحاكمية لله عز وجل وإن المسلم خاضع لربه سبحانه وتعالى في كل شؤون الحياة. في شتى المجالات سواء في المجال الاجتماعي أو الاقتصادي أو السياسي في كل ذلك يخضع.
Sufi leaders accept that they were slow to recognize the trends.
الله أكبر.
in a sense, we are late, to be honest, because the Salafi are more organized than the Sufi people. But I think we need to shift. We are late, but this is a lesson for us. There is big amount of Sufi people who are not very pleased for what is happening in the Sudan.
However, late in the day, the Sufis intend to fight back.
We cannot just fight what is happening in Sudan with bare hands. No. We need to have the facilities. We need to have ourselves organized. We need to use the media. We need to have our own media. We need to have our Islamic teaching launched to universities. A hell of a lot to be done. But we'll never surrender.
But many believe that the spread of Salafism is almost unstoppable.
It's already crossed the boundaries, the regions, in the Gulf area, in North Africa, in West Africa, in Central Africa, and in East Africa. Huge numbers of Salafi are growing in Sudan. Even if you witness their places, their mosques, you will find that they agglomerate and they gather in specific days and in specific mosques. And if you just take a glance or a simple observation, you will find that these people are so many.
Other analysts believe the move amongst the young towards Salafism has come through frustration at those currently in power.
Many students are not happy with the Muslim Brotherhood movement, which in Sudan calls itself the modern Islamic movement. They see a gap between the ideals and the practice. Yani they are critical of the behavior of the Islamic government, corruption, lack of consultation. And therefore, rather than moving towards secular or leftist ideology, they move rightwards toward more fundamentalist ideology.
President Bashir has pronounced on numerous occasions that his long-term vision for the country lies in implementing strict adherence to Sharia law.
The deep religious sentiments is in reconciliation with the Islamic ideology of the government. And this is the tool, or this is the way, that the regime in power is appealing to the public opinion.
والله أنا أتفائل خيراً يعني أتفائل خيراً كثيراً باعتبار أن الساحة السياسية بعد ذلك تفتح مجالاً كما صرح بذلك حكامنا لنشر الإسلام ولتطبيق شريعة الإسلام هذا في بلادنا هنا لأنه في العهد الأول كان كنا نحن من قبل الحكام نمنع كسلفيين ونحارب من قبل السلطة في أن لا ننشر هذا المنهج السلفي فلكن الآن نحن في الساحة في باب الحشاشم لشبكته
But for moderate Muslims like Omar El Fadli that the government appears to be becoming more conservative runs the risk of further alienating the majority of young people.
Today, more than 70% of the youth who don't belong to any political party, they're not represented. We know that we lack freedom, we lack rights, laws are not clear. So the youth, within their own world and their own problems they face every day, they go out after graduation, they don't have a chance.
It's going to turn out to be like Egypt, and I mean, most of us, like people in the streets, right? They're all countless. They don't have money. Everyone's jobs are really bad right now. Like doctors don't have any jobs anymore, and it's just going worse and worse and worse. And people are just not going to, sit and be happy with it. They're all going to come out. I'm sure it's going to happen, but I don't know if it's going to happen now.
If many thousands go out on the streets, will you join them?
Right now? No, I don't think so. Right now, I don't think so.
Can you see Bashir being overthrown?
No comment. I don't know. It's a possibility.
Bit dangerous to talk about today.
Yes.
And yet, historically, it was here amongst the students of Khartoum University that previous revolutions to overthrow unpopular governments were plotted and carried out.
One of the reasons why there is no revolution in the street is that there is no symbol of opposition. Okay, nobody is the leader of the Communist Party. Maulana Muhammad Osman, Sadiq al-Mahdi, all of them, they say we are opposition to the government. But none of them is a symbol, okay? None of them is a model for youngsters or the masses, the common people, to go on the streets to bring them back to power. You ask any Sudanese, are you willing to risk your life in a demonstration so that any of these older leaders come back to power? The answer will be no. What for? They have been here for the last 40 years and nothing, they didn't really do anything for the country.
But even in the absence of a symbol of opposition or a united cause, it appears that unrest has been growing in recent times.
It has already started in small scale, maybe, because of this problem of unemployment and poverty, and as they perceive it and see it, the unjust distribution of the wealth of the nation. But also they see the corruption that is rampant and that is clear, and so they want to change that. But the government has clamped down heavily on these uprisings that have started in different parts of the country.
Hamlet Girifna! حملت قرفنا حملة مخاطبة جماهيرية
ها
مخاطبة جماهيرية
بشنو
حملة
حملة شنو
شباب عاملينها نحن
قال يا ذل شباب معك وينهم
ما دقيقة
ذل امشي معي عاملين نجوا
الناس تحت قصي
في السودان إذا إحنا عايزين ننظم أي اعتراض أو أي مظاهرة أو أي احتجاج سلمي بدون أي عنف بنواجه بأنه الشرطة بتمنعنا لأنه في ما في حرية تعبير بنواجه بأنه بيعتقلونا بيقدموا فينا بلاغات ضد إنه نحن أسينا ضد الدولة جرائم ارتكبنا جرائم ضد الدولة.
مناهل إبراهيم, a recent graduate of Khartoum University, is a leading voice of the opposition group Garifna, which literally translates as fed up. Like many similar groups throughout the Arab world, Garifna uses the internet to spread its message, with President Bashir its number one target.
بعد 20 سنة بدون دليل الموضوع ما هي عاوز ليه ودايك 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 لكن النتيجة تعجبك.
والسودان عنده تجربة بتاعت انتفاضة وثورة في تاريخه أكثر من أي بلد تاني. إحنا عندنا التجربة دي وإحنا شعب لا يقهر, وسونر ليتا احنا حننظم روحنا وقاعدين فعليا بننظم روحنا باي شكل.
The demonstrations follow a pattern where the leaders are arrested by security or police. Manahil claims that many of her associates have been tortured. But in Sudan, such claims are difficult to prove either way. Asim Altikana, head of the student wing of the governing party, the NCP, agreed to meet with Manahil. He argues that President Bashir is in fact popular with the masses, and that opposition to him is negligible.
وشهد الناس كيف أن البشير خرج إلى الناس وكيف أن الناس استقبلوه. فإذا قسنا ذلك ببقية الأحزاب التي عندما خرجت أو خرج قيادتها إلى الشعب لم يستقبلهم أحد. فهذا دليل واضح على شعبية المؤتمر الوطني. والمؤتمر الوطني هو جاء حسب رغبة الشعب السوداني.
الناس اللي ما طلعوا طبعاً كلام عاصم الغال وده غريب جدا زي كأنه ما على أرض الواقع. الناس بتخاف من الأجهزة الغمعية لأنك لما تطلع الشارع البوليس بيضربك. تاريخيا نحن عندنا يعني ناس كتار معتقلين هسي ومعتقلين في الأيام الفاتت واعتقلتوهم وضربتوهم ودخلتوهم وحاكمتوهم. إذا كان أنت بتعترف بحرية التعبير أنت ليه ما دار تعمل الحاجة دي؟ أنت ليه ما دار تعمل تديهم حق التعبير وخليهم يتظاهروا؟
هي حرية جيدة لأنه الآن متاح لكل الأحزاب إنها تقول الكلمة اللي هي دار تقولها وكل الأحزاب عندها جرائد تتكلم عن نفسها والآن ممكن الرئيس الجمهورية يسب يعني أو يلعن سواء كان في الجرائد أو سواء كان في المنابر منابر الطلاب خاصة أنا أتكلم عن باعتبار طالب في جامعة الخرطوم جامعة الخرطوم باعتبار جامعة رائدة أي شخص يستطيع أن يتحدث ويقول ما يرى في النظام من عيوب أو من مشكلات.
I call Sudan the land of uncertainty. You sleep, you don't know what's going to happen tomorrow.
Professor Mustafa al-Bashir was dismissed from his position as Vice Chancellor of Khartoum University for writing articles which criticized the government.
Those who are sitting on the top are always, of course, have this dilemma of fears of stability. They have to have this very firm grip.
They fear for their own positions, don't they?
Mm-hmm.
They fear for their own position.
Definitely. I have written in that, actually, and even concerning the financial resources of this country, most of it is going now or is used for security purposes, to protect the ruling people and to protect their interests. And to, that is a major element, definitely.
What makes his sacking more significant is that he is a member of the Muslim Brotherhood, and was originally one of the government's strongest supporters.
I thought probably when the Islamists, they came to the government, they are going to make a real change. But to my disappointment, that did not happen. And I feel still we are not doing what we are expected to do.
Political Islam has been a failure.
Because of many reasons, in to some extent. Definitely. When a poor steals, you cut the hand. But when somebody who is in higher ranking position steals, you ignore. And that was a big crime, actually, in Islam. This is a statement of the Prophet, actually. So the implementation is not as supposed to be. A change is needing, and the message is coming from many people, from within the Congress, National Congress Party, from the opposition party, from the youngsters through in the internet now. A lot of messages have been exchanged, calling for change, and a day will come we have a change. But hopefully we want to see it soon, better than late.
Said Tabidi, who had returned to Sudan from the United States to consider resettling in his homeland, had been surprised at the lack of protest considering his country's history of revolution.
Here in Sudan, we went out on the street several times, and every time they go out on the street, they change the government in one day. In one day, because everybody comes out. But this time people are not the same. Even people in the capital here, they're from all over. They are not one nation anymore. That's one of the reasons that we are different. We are totally different. There's Sufis, there's Salafists, there's other tribes, a lot of other tribes, a lot of people that speak even different languages. So we are not the same.
People are not going to make any uprising or anything. I don't think so.
Saeed has now spent 2 months with elder brother Bulbul and his family. Bulbul's own frustration with the government lies with the fact that he believes that they will create distractions to stop people even thinking about change.
بدون مشاكل الناس هيبتدوا يفكروا في انهم عايزين يكونوا جريت نيشن امه عظيمه صح اول ما الناس يبتدوا يفكروا عايزين يتحضروا عايزين يتعلموا عايزين يفكروا بحريه عايزين يتكلموا بحريه.
For Omar al-Fadli, while he's troubled by the state of the country, there is comfort in the fact that at least people like Saeed appear to be ready to return to try and change things.
I'm truly very pessimistic. If we go out of the capital, you'll find there is no clean water, there is no electricity. I admire a young guy like my friend Saeed. It takes courage, it takes sacrifice to come from a well-developed countries with a developed system, with security, with all what you can call as welfare and so on, to leave that, to come back and be part of an undeveloped country and fight. It takes courage, it takes a lot of sacrifice.
Came here with an open mind. What's your decision?
Going back to the States. Going back to the States. Till something happened here, change or anything, then I'll come back again.
Not before?
Not before.
With the economy stagnating, a rise in religious conservatism, and a nervous government desperate to keep protests down, it's unlikely that Saeed Tabidi will choose to move back to his homeland anytime soon.